Hello viewers, my name is Tyler Marchand, and today we're looking at my picks for the best hit songs of 2006. This video is coming out super early because I am planning a two-day trip to nearby Yosemite National Park in the middle of next week. And since school is finally out for me, I can alter my listening schedule to listen to the songs for this year and for the next video while still keeping the one video per week quota. Anyways, I'll just say this right now. 2006 is probably the worst year I've covered so far. Despite the fact that this year is right in the middle of the most nostalgic time period for me, not a lot of the songs that were hits this year were good. You have songs where a guy is bragging that his dick is basically only 2 inches long, a woman acting proud that she has no control over whether or not her panties stay on, a guy who wants a woman to imagine his dick is bubblegum, and a man that Mark Grondin of Spectrum Pulse, a guy that he described as one of the best vocalists of all time, bragging that he gets more ass than a toilet seat. Granted, I was still able to find 15 songs to talk about from this year, but there weren't many other songs that were toward the upper quality region for me. Before I get started, my regretted omission from last year, and I can't believe I forgot this, is Sugar, We're Going Down. Now on to the 5 honorable mentions. Admittedly, I'm not much of a fan of Christina Aguilera. The woman can sing, but I've always thought that the diva personality was a bit out of place for most of her tracks. Not this one. The classical instrumentation suits Christina's diva side almost perfectly, with her delivery of the lyrics regarding her new husband fitting well with the instrumentation. It's a shame that I don't hear this song anymore. Speaking of songs that should be played far more often than they currently are. Again, I wouldn't really call myself a Mary J. Blige fan either. She's been around for quite a while. She actually had a top 5 hit on my birth week with Not Gonna Cry, but her only song I've rarely ever heard frequently enough to know and like was Family Affair. If this gorgeous piano ballad were played more frequently in Reno, I'd listen in without hesitation, since Mary J. sounds amazing vocally, and that helps to sell the lyrics about needing to be with that special someone at all times. Once again, beautiful song. I still hear this song quite a bit today, and I really do like the signature song from the Denver piano band The Fray. The lyrics detail singer Isaac Slade's experience with working at a counseling center for troubled teens, with the biggest influence being a 17-year-old that had a cocaine addiction and whom no one could seemingly help. When it comes to songs from this group, I really like this song. Although, I'm also a fan of this song, which wasn't as huge as How to Save a Life was, but was still pretty big all the same. I don't hear this song as much as How to Save a Life, which is a shame since this song is also a personal one for the lead vocalist, who is trying to reconnect with his younger brother since they started drifting apart. This song was actually nominated for an award at the Grammys, but lost to Really? But Okay, I imagine that out of all the songs I've referenced on my lists that I've done so far, this will provoke the biggest surprise from all of you. Most people view Rascal Flatts as everything that is wrong with country music. I mean, aside from bro country, that is. But I truly have a soft spot for them. Lead vocalist Gary LaVox has one of the most iconic country voices out there, and he helps sell the song about losing his father, although credit is also due to the instrumentation, courtesy of the rest of the band. I feel I can't be a true music critic if I don't put a few questionable choices on my list, so whenever that happens, I'm sure you all understand. Okay, those were my five honorable mentions. It's time to get on to the best of the year, shall we? Number 10. I think I've beaten it home at this point that I live in Nevada, so this entry really shouldn't be a surprise. I'll admit that whenever I hear this song, and it does get played quite a bit today in Reno, I mainly listen just so that I can blurt out, "I chime in with a haven't you people ever heard of, closing the goddamn door." As such, I rarely stop to listen to the lyrics of the song. It was only a couple days ago, when I was forced to listen through it entirely, that I learned from said lyrics that Brendan Urie is a groom at a wedding when he overhears that it isn't a well-kept secret that his bride has a problem keeping her legs shut. What's interesting is that he seems to take the blow with just an, "Oh well, whatever." But when you have the harpsichord opening up the song and the sudden shift from verses to choruses courtesy of that rock instrumentation, I really don't care about that. I still enjoy this song all the same. Number 9. Be honest, is there anyone who didn't see this entry coming? This is one of those songs that is almost essential to put on a 2006 best list, but for me, it is only in at number 9. That does not mean that the song isn't amazing, since it is, don't get me wrong. I just have 8 songs that I'd prefer to listen to over this one. This song has residual airplay today, but when I do hear it, I will enjoy this soulful song from producer Danger Mouse and soul singer CeeLo Green that was a viral hit back in 2006. One very interesting thing I found out about this song was that it was originally a demo for the Pussycat Dolls. Isn't it crazy how things very nearly turn out? Number 8. How often can you say that performing a song on American Idol will get a Scottish folk rock song to chart in the United States? Well, considering this song was only a minor hit in America, I tend to think that my local adult contemporary station plays this song frequently since it is truly unique and sounds like nothing else that was released around that time or has been released ever since. Whatever the radio station's decision for playing this song, I'm all on board, since the song is fantastic. Admittedly, this song is mostly acoustic guitars and claps, but the combination of the guitars with the woohoos makes this song sound far different from anything that has become a hit ever since, and lyrics about trying to balance out the right decisions with your heart's desires adds another layer to this classic that I still love to this day. Number 7. If there was a producer who owned the mid to late 2000s in terms of hit songs that have aged phenomenally, that producer would be none other than Tim Mosley, aka the man who made this club classic. Oh, At this time frame, Timbaland became a big name, producing some of the most recognizable club songs of the mid to late 2000s. I personally say that out of his output, this is my absolute favorite, where he and Canadian indie singer Nelly Furtado are playing off each other as two horny people at a club who instantly feel attraction to one another. Nelly initially plays hard to get, but as the song progresses, she becomes more flirtatious, which throws Timbaland off. Today, I only really hear this song when people request it on local stations, but on the off chance that I do hear the song, I will listen for the catchy-as-hell keys that play throughout the chorus, as well as that little guitar interlude that closes out the song. Number 6. This is a song that I frequently heard when I did karate as an extracurricular activity, as it was played quite a bit in the studio. And I even had a nice memory of dancing to this song for a dance unit of my 8th grade physical education class in 2009. Regrettably, I don't hear this song that much today, but interestingly, I instead hear the song that this track sampled. Oh yeah, you know where this is going. Barbadian singer Rihanna had her first hit back in 2005, but it wasn't until 2006 that she had her first chart topper, and at only 18 years old. Here's a bit of an interesting tidbit of trivia for you all. She actually has the same birthday as me, just 8 years older. The Tainted Love sample creates a very bouncy instrumentation, and it works phenomenally with this song where Rihanna is in an interesting relationship, to say the least. Even as an adolescent, even as she was a teenager, her vocal performance was very captivating, and this song still intrigues me to this day, just as much as it did back when I was 10 years old. Number 5. Much like Black Horse and the Cherry Tree, this song is a song that only really got as big as it did thanks to TV, specifically its inclusion in the season finale of a soap opera. The man behind this song later said that within hours after that show aired, the song was at the top of the iTunes' top 100 songs. Yeah, iTunes started to become big at this time. I think you'll see why this song blew up immediately. If anyone has ever said that you need lots of complex lyrics to make a love song work, they clearly haven't heard this alternative rock classic that still gets lots of spins on Reno stations today. The three verses barely have more than 50 words total. By comparison, in the song Gucci Gang, the phrase is said 54 times throughout the song. But the lyrics here still hit home, thanks to the instrumentation that starts out slow, but comes to a head during that final chorus. I don't know what to say about this song that hasn't already been said. It is truly spectacular, and you have to have lived under a rock to have never heard of this song before. By the way, Snow Patrol also have some other good songs in their catalog, like Run if you're interested. Do keep in mind that that song is like 6 minutes though. Number 4. Going back to my time spent doing karate, at this time period, thanks to the growing popularity of iTunes, my brother and I were given the choice to recommend songs to be purchased from said site if we liked them enough. These are songs that we would hear at karate. This would lead to big arguments between my brother and I over what songs were better. For example, back in 2006, he liked Sean Paul's Temperature, which I'll admit has kind of rubbed off on me to the point where it just barely missed this list. but my choice for that time frame is one that I hope you'll side with me on. Okay, long before Despacito and I Like It became reggaeton smashes, Shakira had her biggest American hit with this phenomenal dance track that I only ever hear today on reggaeton stations. By the way, it's not going to be until I get to my number one pick that we come across a song that I still hear frequently today. Anyway, I've always loved the salsa instrumentation, Shakira's great vocal performance throughout, and Fugees member Wyclef Jean's parts, especially. Never really knew that she could dance like this. Jamaica man wanna speak Spanish. Como se llama? Bonita. Mi casa. Su casa. And yeah, the lyrics are basically just Shakira saying that this man at the club makes her wanna dance. Hence the hips don't lie part. But who honestly focuses in on the lyrics when you have fun instrumentation like this to dance along to? Number 3. People tend to think that rock music wasn't that good in this time period, considering that one of the biggest rock hits of this era was a song that glorified cheating. But at least for me, rock was still very good at this time. As proof, my top 3 songs of the year, well, maybe 2.5, are all rock songs. Let's start with the rock song that is an anthem for the ages. This rock band from northern Oklahoma is one that had decent rock success during the second half of the 2000s decade, with most of their songs being good, but not fantastic. This song, however, is fantastic. Courtesy of the drums that open up the song, the guitar work, and the anthemic vocal performance, this song about persevering through the worst of your days is a song that if I am graced with hearing it on the radio, I will enjoy every second of it. Perhaps my favorite parts come from those little transitions between the verses and the choruses, along with that piano breakdown before the final chorus. Again, I am shocked that this doesn't get in much airplay today. Number 2. It was up to a few years ago that I still heard this song played in Reno, but it seems to have been forgotten since then on pop, rock, and country stations. I have to ask, why? Who would have thought that Heartland rocker Jon Bon Jovi could make fantastic country music? Courtesy the country label most likely comes from the guest featured Jennifer Nettles from Texas pop country group Sugarland, but when you have the violins that open up this song and the lyrics about missing home so much that all the wonderful places out there lose their charm, this is a song that deserves far more than it has gotten in recent years. Bon Jovi and Nettles sing the song phenomenally, and they both sound fantastic together, especially in the bridge part right before that final chorus. Now you're probably wondering, what song could be better than this one? Some of you who have seen my previous videos might have a good idea. Number 1. This is going to be the year that ends the streak that was going of my best hit song of the year being a year-end top 10 hit. But this song was still a big hit nevertheless. Some of my fondest memories of this song came from playing it on Rock Band. I liked playing that game as well as the Guitar Hero games throughout my adolescent years. And imagine my surprise when I found out that my family actually owned the song thanks to its feature in a Grammy nominee's disc. As a side note, I find it interesting how the absolute worst song of the year was right next to the best song of the year in chart position. When it comes to Red Hot Chili Peppers' hit songs, this is one of their best as well as one of their biggest. The lyrics tell the story about a rebellious woman from the South who lives a life of crime, but this attracts the attention of singer Anthony Kiedis. She meets her end in the Badlands of the Dakotas, but there is also a hidden subtext to the lyrics, with the girl representing California, the state, and the decline of society. This is a subtext that can also be found in their 1999 hit, Californication, but what attracts me most about the song is the instrumentation. Courtesy of John Frusciante, the guitar work is what I love most, from the way that the guitars are relatively subdued for the verses, to how they explode into power chords for those choruses, and that Jimi Hendrix-esque ending guitar solo that I always listened for and have always enjoyed playing when I would play Rock Band. All in all, Danny California by the Red Hot Chili Peppers is my pick for the best hit song of 2006. Well, that was my list. If you liked the video, share it with others, subscribe to my channel so that you know when I have new material out, and as always, if you decide to comment down below, be kind with your words. Next week, I'm going to be talking about 2007, a year that I am really looking forward to after this year. Stay tuned for that video. Until then, I'm Tyler Marchand, and I'll see you later. Take care.